actually many patients in our daily practice we do see with low back pain. So it's a very common complaint. So how to go about it? Because it's particularly called spondyloarthritis or inflammatory arthritis. Maybe on paper it may not be looking so serious, but down the line when you look at those patients, by after 15-20 years, suddenly when somebody tells, no, no, you already have spondyloarthritis or ankylosing spondylitis, things have already got fused, people are really taken aback. So many times if we pick it up early and they ask them to do a lot of exercise and lifestyle modifications, they do well on a longer term. So going directly into the topic. So first we should know what is inflammatory back pain. Anybody comes with a back pain, particularly young people, more common in males. But nowadays what we used to study in ankylosing spondylitis is that 8:9:1 male to female has slowly started reducing. Maybe with the advent of MRI we have started picking up more cases earlier even in females. So now there is a different term called as spondyloarthritis. Or sometimes if x-ray is normal and only MRI is there, what we call a non-radiographic axial spondyloarthritis, the incidence or the difference between males and females are really come down. So we shouldn't be really surprised if a female presents with something like an axe-spondylitis symptom. So patient has a low back pain which is more in the morning time when they get up, like a morning stiffness, or in the night time, particularly in the early morning, if it disturbs the sleep, these are some of the typical symptoms what we should think that points towards the inflammatory back pain. So any pain which disturbs sleep, we should be careful. It not be not only spondyloarthritis, it might be even a malignancy. So recently I had a patient who had a typical nocturnal pain, presented like a polyarthritis. Actually asked for a basic hemogram, ESR and CRP, but after 3 days she got admitted in another hospital with bleeding. So when they saw they had no platelets, actually she had a leukemia. So when we first thought, another physician referred to me as a inflammatory polyarthritis, but actually it was a case of leukemia. But if you go into the history, she typically had that nocturnal pain. So anything which comes in the night disturbs sleep, it's not going to be a normal, simple mechanical like a lumbar spondylosis or something. Because any mechanical back pain, it will be more when you are in the erect position. Once we are in the lying down position, it gets relieved. That is a typical one which many of us maintain. But anything which comes in the night, we have to be a little bit more careful. So all these things tell the same thing. Engage, morning stiffness, more pain at the night, better with exercise, bad with rest. Just opposite of what all the mechanical pain we have. It will be usually, once we exert, we have pain and we take rest, it becomes better, but it will be the other way around. So before going to the topic proper, just touching on these things. So spondyloarthritis, now it has become an umbrella term where we put everything, ankylosing spondylitis, psoriatic arthritis, reactive arthritis. All these things are put under a common term called spondyloarthritis. So before going into the imaging part, so usually the hero of this particular topic is nothing but the sacroiliac joint. Because it is the joint at which any inflammatory like spondyloarthritis starts initially, then only it starts touching the other joints like spine. So whenever you think of spondyloarthritis, always ask imaging of the pelvis, mainly to look for the sacroiliac joint. Whether it's going to be x-ray or MRI, we will see sooner. So actually in sacroiliac joint, it's not a very, if you remember our anatomical classes or the the skeleton, you can see that it will be in an oblique way. So it's not so easy to picture the full sacroiliac joint unlike a knee joint or some other joint. So usually there are some modified views, what they call Ferguson view. But what they found is a simple pelvis AP view is more than enough. It doesn't really, the modified Ferguson view doesn't really score over a simple AP view. So whenever you want to ask for X-ray, ask for a simple pelvis AP view. So we are more bothered about the antero-inferior part, that is called the true part or the synovial part. Whereas the posterior-superior part is more like a cartilaginous part. So what we are of the antero-inferior part. So this is the part where we are bothered, antero and inferior. So here we have a case, you can just give your opinion, because most of the things hereafter is going to be only case descriptions, many of them which we saw in our day-to-day practice. So young male, low back pain for 5 years, it started after road traffic accident. See, always this is a catch. Many times when you see any patient, particularly with any arthritis or pain, always they try to attribute to a pain, to a trauma or to a foot. This is our normal non-medical person's mindset. Always they try to attribute to a trauma, or it might be they tell they took something and it happened like this. So this patient also told that it was after a road traffic accident. There was gradual worsening, mainly it was in the buttock. So any time when somebody complains of alternating buttock pain, think of spondyloarthritis or inflammatory back pain. Occasionally he also had ribcage pain. Sometimes people can have costochondritis. because cost of contralateral joints and also cost of vertebral joints, these also can be involved in spondyloarthritis. So, and typical morning stiffness and night pain he used to get up because of the severe pain. So, these are all the typical things, and main thing he had a good response to NSAID like a diclofenac. So, is this history suggestive of an inflammatory back pain? So, it's a very typical history of inflammatory back pain. Other than that, he also started losing weight. Family history, that is another important thing. Grandfather also had a similar history and he became bedbound pretty early in his life. He was also a smoker. Nowadays, not only for rheumatoid arthritis, also for spondyloarthritis, smoking has been found to be a very strong risk factor. Anyway, smoking, I don't think in any way, unlike alcohol, there is nothing to debate about smoking. Anyway, it's harmful. So, just tell not to smoke, not only for the heart, also for the joints. In examination, he had restricted movements, both the chest and also the lumbar spine. So, his investigation had high inflammatory markers and HLA-B21 was positive. So, this was a patient who had a symptom duration of 5 years. So, what is the first imaging modality we will ask for in this patient? Will it be an X-ray or an MRI?
It's an MRI.
Okay, always basics like whatever teachers taught us, the same thing still holds good. Even definitely, this patient has a chronic back pain. So, definitely X-ray is the first imaging modality. Even if the patient had told like it was only there for 6 months, still X-ray will be the first imaging modality because it is cheaper unless it, we are dealing with a pregnant patient or something. So, many times patients may underreport or they may come to us only when the pain becomes really bad. So, the real 6 months or 3 months they tell may not be the real 3 months. They might have had intermittent pain before and they are presented to us normally. So, always the first modality of choice is X-ray, because if something is going to be picked up on X-ray, there is no need to go in for a costly investigation like an MRI. So, this was the initial criteria when we had only X-ray. So, here what they wanted is clinical symptom like a low back pain, like inflammatory back pain. There should be restriction of movements like examination, there should be findings both in the lumbar spine and also chest expansion. With there should be sacroiliitis, that is grade 2 bilaterally, or if it is going to be one side, grade 3 to 4. So, this was the criteria. So, we need X-ray thing plus a clinical thing. So, when these things, two things are there, we used to diagnose ankylosing spondylitis. Now, the change in paradigm is with the MRI, we need not wait for the changes to evolve on a X-ray. We can pick it up earlier in the MRI itself. So, here same inflammatory back pain, anybody with a low back pain which you think is inflammatory, if the X-ray is normal, you can go in for an MRI. If MRI, that is sacroiliitis, it is called as spondyloarthritis. Sometimes patients as a pacemaker not able to go for an MRI, you have another arm called as clinical arm. This is called the radiological arm, this is called the clinical arm. So, here you have HLA-B21, because HLA-B21, again remember all the immunological tests are not 100% positive. Similarly, HLA-B21 will be positive only in around 80% of the patient. Maybe in the Caucasians, maybe around 90%, but here it is little bit less. So, if HLA-B21 is positive, if any of these things are there, not only inflammatory back pain, predominantly lower limb joint pain, or dactylitis, enthesitis, always look whether the patient is complaining of a heel pain, or patient has psoriasis, or family history of psoriasis is there. Many times scalp, dandruff, scalp psoriasis can be missed. So, unless we ask, patient may not know that the skin lesion and the joint pains are related. So, psoriasis, unless we ask, patients never volunteer. So, think about that also. So, if these things are there, 2 is there in this, with HLA-B21 we can diagnose, or if only imaging it is there, with just 1 point we can diagnose. Okay, coming to the imaging proper. So, this is how the normal SA joint looks in an X-ray. So, this is how it looks on a CT. See, for practical purposes, usually we don't ask for a CT. Unless, as I told, MRI patient is not able to lie in the, means it takes time, at least half an hour, 45 minutes. So, some other contraindication there, then we go for CT. Because X-ray and CT, we see only chronic changes, whereas what you call an active change, like a bone marrow edema, will be visible only on MRI. So, usually for practical purposes, very rarely we do CT, maybe in GHMMC, when you used to study, due to affordability reasons, many patients we used to do CT pelvis. Otherwise, in practice outside, we hardly do. Either stop with X-ray or you can go for an MRI. So, in MRI, you ask for 2 things. One is the T1, which all of us know. Other thing is we ask for something called stir sequence. That is mainly to highlight the fluid content in there. So, this is actually a normal SA joint. So, nothing is there in there. So, this is actually, here in the SA joint, you can see there is some sclerosis. Called sclerosis. Anything, whenever there is a what we call bone marrow edema or inflammation, there will be a reactive reparative process called as sclerosis. So, look for sclerosis, see how the joint space is. These are the things still to be seen. So, maybe this is a pretty grossly abnormal MRI. You can see there is a lot of sclerosis and the margins are serrated. Actually, it will be something like a stamp temporarily, like a stamp, you know, how the serrated margins will be. Then later it might be become a bigger erosion. and the last stage will be something like this one. Here you can't see an SA joint. There is no joint. Maybe here you can see a little bit on the right side. There is no SA joint. It's fully fused, and this is nothing but the ligaments which are got calcified, which looks like a star shape appearance. So there is no SA joint on the right side. So it's fully fused. So sometimes fusion of the SA joint is also a good way in the sense patient won't feel pain, but due to lack of movement in the long term, they will go in for severe osteoporosis there. So this is the next thing in the spine. What we see is we see whether there is any syndesmophyte or not. So you can see whether there is a bridging between two vertebral bodies. So here it started, here it is almost complete. Here you can see it's full blown fusion. So anteriorly you see for syndesmophyte. Posteriorly many times, particularly males, they come only with neck pain. What we see is there is something called facet joints here between two things. Here you have facet joints. So those two things also can get fused. They won't have any rotation at all. So these are some of the things which are to be seen in the MRI. So this is in the lumbar spine. Here you can see there is a sclerosis like thing in this vertebral body and also in this, and the margins are irregular. So this is something called as Anderson lesion or spondylodiscitis. Here actually the lesion has become a bit more severe and it has actually gone for a fracture. So any bamboo spine like thing, suddenly if there are sudden jerky movements, you should tell them not to travel on a bumpy road. There shouldn't be any jerky movements. They can go in for a fracture. So that also, though there is lot of new bone formation in ankylosing spondylitis, none of them are healthy. They are all osteoporotic bones, so they can easily fracture. So in MRI, this is what I was telling. So in X-ray, we'll be leading only with sclerosis, erosion, all these things. Whereas in MRI is where we see this bone marrow edema. So forget about capsulitis, synovitis, enthesitis. It's very rare to pick up those things. Just remember bone marrow edema. Whenever you see MRI, always see the stiff sequence. So I will just let you know how to see the stiff sequence. There you just see whether there are any bright spots or there are not. So this is a T1, this is T2. Remember in T1 you will see the fat as a white layer. So this is how we can differentiate. Whereas here you won't see the fat as a white layer. This is the way in which I differentiate. Other findings are there, like how to see the CSF and all. So in SA joint CSF, seeing the CSF is difficult. So just see the fat. If it is in a white layer, it is a T1. In T2 it won't be seen. And here you can see bright spots are there in the SA joint. So here it is pretty obvious. This is called as bone marrow edema and what we call it as a sacroiliitis. Similarly, here actually in T1 you see lot of white images. In T2, still you see it as a dark images. So these are nothing but fatty lesions. Sometimes patient comes to you, they may not have active lesions in still. They might have only have fatty lesions in the T1 cuts. So it means the patient had inflammation in the past and it has healed to become a fatty lesion. Even that is important to pick up a diagnosis case. Means I had a kid who came with just a heel pain, he had Achilles tendinitis, nothing else. In MRI, there was no reporting as an active sacroiliitis. But when we saw the film, there are a lot of fatty changes. Then when we went back to the radiologist and asked them, then they told, yeah, this could be possibly evidence of previous inflammation. So always T2 or stir is our main importance, but in case if there is no evidence of inflammation like bone marrow edema is not there, still go back to T1, see whether any fatty changes are there or not. So this is the spine. Similarly here you can see what we used to in X-rays we call anterior corner, posterior corner. Similarly you can see these fatty changes. So in MRI, in T1, if you see these fatty changes, those are the sites where you can have new bone formation. So try to see these in T1, always look for fatty changes in the spine. Whereas here in stiff image you can see lot of white areas which are highlighted, they are nothing but bone marrow edema. So going to the case scenarios. So this was a 30 odd male. He came with severe back pain almost for the past 10 years. So anybody want to hear about it, or just case scenarios you can just tell more about me.
Calcification
of this. Yes, sir. There is definitely, it's so obvious this calcification is there. Maybe syndesmophytes also looks like syndesmophytes.
Bamboo spine,
okay sir. So disc calcification is usually we don't see in spondyloarthritis. So disc calcification usually happens in either severe osteoarthritis or other degenerative conditions. Always whenever you see has suspicion of ankylosing spondylitis or spondyloarthritis, immediately go and look for the SA joint. Sorry for the quality, here it is not so great. Actually in this patient the SA joint was normal. So if it is spondyloarthritis, sacroiliac joint will be definitely involved, whereas other conditions like degenerative conditions, it won't be involved. So I think now it might be easier. He had some pigmentation, not a common condition. It has been there since childhood. Exactly. So it is nothing but blackish pigmentation, so ochronosis. So disc calcification always think of acronosis, or it might be even a severe degeneration. Sometimes you see really bad degeneration, you might think of some fancy diagnosis, but in the end it will be just a, like a simple osteoarthritis of knee, it will be a simple osteoarthritis of the spine. So this is a middle-aged female. She had a low back pain which has been there in the more in the daytime, and when she gets lies down after some time it gets relieved. I hope the image is, so just concentrate on the SA joint, whether anything can be seen. She was she had our 3-4 kids actually.
Sclerosis of both SA joints.
Exactly, sir. So sir was spot on. So there is sclerosis of both SA joints. So whenever we see sclerosis, immediately the thing will come whether it is a spondyloarthritis or not. A simple spondyloarthritis won't just have a sclerosis, usually you will have erosions. Maybe X-ray alone may not be enough, but here you see something called a triangular pattern of sclerosis. This is very, very common in, typically described in multiparous, but even I have seen in patients with even a single pregnancy also. It is called osteitis condensus EE. It's very common. Maybe once you start seeing X-rays, many patients will have this pattern. So a triangular pattern predominantly present on the iliac side, which has like this on uniformly on both sides. It's called osteitis condensus EE. Just reassure the patient, ask them to do back strengthening exercise. Nothing else to be done, not even an MRI is needed for them. So this was a 60-70 year old male. Patient was referred because he had some changes like a spondylodiscitis. Do you feel that this is a syndesmophyte or anything else like these ones?
Spine is so straight.
Okay, sir.
This is passive.
Yeah, definitely, sir. Correct. So main thing is whether these, as I told, yeah, definitely the patient was in severe pain. He was in the, actually also as an inpatient, so he was in severe spasm. So that is the reason it's a straight and spine. So what we can see here, there are some fights. So what we see in ankylosing spondylitis is called syndesmophyte. Whereas these are nothing but what you call osteophytes or paraspinal fight. For practical reasons, may not hold, be always correct. Whenever the fights are oriented in a vertical direction, touching the, along with the, in line with the vertebral body, it's going to be more of a syndesmophyte. So whenever it is going in a little bit horizontal direction, it is going to be more of an osteophyte or a paraspinal fight. So it means it's not due to a spondylarthritis, it's due to a degenerative. So here actually there is severe degeneration. So many times Anderson lesion, what I call spondylodiscitis, and differentiating a degeneration with small snouts, it's pretty difficult. So always it's better, see I'm not a radiologist, so always whenever we are in doubt, we just go to a radiologist and ask their help. We tell the clinical picture, the investigation, so that they will also be in a better position to come to a conclusion. So this was nothing but a simple degeneration, just put this because to see severe, it looks as if the vertebral bodies are destroyed. Actually patient even had a PET scan, somebody thought it was a malignancy with metastasis, of course PET scan was normal. So this was a chap from Andhra, saw in Vijay Hospital. So he had again severe mechanical back pain. So Andhra Pradesh is a group. So actually you can see the whole bones, there is large white bones. So it's a typical fluorosis. I couldn't follow that patient, I just gave him fluoride level, he just disappeared. So it's a typical fluorosis. Again, usually the SA joint will be normal. If you take a CT or MRI, we should be, because here it's almost white out, it's very difficult to see the SA joint. So it is another closed ED. So fluorosis, acronosis, all these are closed differential diagnosis of spondyloarthritis. This is actually even more common condition. Again, it was referred by my colleague orthopedician to me because they thought it was ankylosing spondylitis. Patient had neck pain, back pain, he was a diabetic. So syndesmophytes usually will be something like a pencil shape. It will be very, what do you call, slim and lean. Here you can see lot of bulky ones actually. I think I heard somebody do. Exactly. So diabetics, actually this is the most, of all the images I will be discussing, this is the most common actually. If we start looking out for this dish, what we call diffuse idiopathic skeletal hyperostosis. It's a big name, but thing is that there is no treatment for it. We have to just tell them that it's physiotherapy. The only thing, many times because they think it is some other disease, these people go around. Sometimes we have even caught patients where they already got a biologic. It's sad, but shouldn't happen, but I'm just telling you. So that is the reason it is pretty common, more common in diabetics, bit more common in the elderly group. Again, dish, if you see the SA joint, usually SA joint will be spared. So many times it's very difficult because in psoriatic arthritis also you can have changes like spondyloarthritis. There also you get all these bulky syndesmophytes. So that confuses, gets confused with this dish. So remember dish, which is pretty common. See the thoracic spine, you will have flowing osteophytes. So that tells whether it's a dish or not. So here actually arrow marks are there. Anybody wants to So is this SI joint normal or abnormal?
Abnormal.
Okay, sir. Actually, correct. It looks abnormal. Even I thought when I first thought him is, actually it was from online course. So the point here is bubble shadows are there. So whenever there is a bubble shadow over the SI joint, never interpret it. Actually, it was a normal SI joint. Because of the bubble shadows, it looks like that. So I'm skipping this. And other thing, whenever you think of a unilateral sacroiliac joint, not restricted only to the iliac, going into the surrounding muscles, extending beyond the borders, always think of an abscess or infection. So unilateral, extending beyond the borders, lot of muscle edema, always think of infection. This is actually a past history of pyogenic involvement of the sacroiliac joint. It got fully fused. So here you can see there is lot of muscle edema. If it is only spondyloarthritis, it will be restricted only to the sacrum and ilium. You can see muscle edema here, here. So whenever unilateral extending out, just think of that. Postpartum, last couple of cases, she had low back pain. So when we took an MRI, we saw this. Again, this might be a very common thing. Many times we may not do an MRI because patient came to me, I already X-ray was normal, I had to do an MRI. So this is nothing but an insufficiency fracture. So always think of, say, vitamin D, it's, all of us do, it's all 90% it's low only. So thing is that which patient really has a symptom due to vitamin D deficiency, picking that point is actually very challenging. So think of insufficiency fracture. There also bone marrow edema will be there. So doesn't mean it's a sacroiliitis and spondyloarthritis. Other clue is whenever you see SI joint, always see the hip joint. So take home messages will be, first clinically decide the type of back pain. Always X-ray first, then go for MRI. The role of CT is minimal. Unless your patient can't go for an MRI or want to see for bony erosions, you can go for that. And asking for MRI, this is the main take home message. Many times we see just a lumbosacral spine MRI being asked. Always ask either at least a screening of the pelvis so that SI joint and hip joint will be included. Or if you are going to see the pelvis, at least ask for screening of the lumbosacral spine. So always join both together. Never leave the lumbosacral spine alone and the SI joint, hip joint. So at least ask screening if the radiologist or the center is going to charge for that. Just tell them screening, no need to give the full. At least tell them the oral report that SI joint or hip joint is normal. Because patients will have LS spine MRI, but SI joint wouldn't have been included in that. And most important thing is, whenever you are out, even if you are outside, patient might go to XY or any private center, all the radiologists tell the clinical picture. Because I had a patient recently, he has given sacroiliitis, but in the film couldn't make out any sacroiliitis. So you have to call to the radiologist. Sometimes they may not give the particular film where the finding is there. So always interact with the radiologist, because unlike us, they don't see the patient. So when we interact with that, many times it saves a lot of hassles for the patient. Thank you.
Concentrate more on the
syndesmophytes, because it's easy to interpret, and if two radiologists or two clinicians are seeing, there won't be much of variability. Whereas coming to the facet joints, two things. One, whatever happens in the anterior of the spine should happen in the posterior of the spine also, and there is no individual radiologic scoring method for a posterior elements actually. Like there are something called Stokes, modified Stokes. All of them see whether syndesmophyte is there, whether it's bridging, anterior, the shiny corner is there, everything is in the anterior. So posterior, there are no scoring systems which have included posterior. That is the reason many times when we see patients, when we even start them on bulging, I tell them, see, already your facet joints are fused, so there is no chance that you will be either able to do extension of the neck or even a rotation. So facet joints are equally important. Only thing, for whatever reason, in the radiological scoring systems or even in trials, it has not been taken into. So even in discussions or debates, when you ask them, the answer they give us is, whatever should happen in the anterior should happen in the posterior also. So it doesn't really matter if you should score them separately. So it's equally important. Posterior also.
Because the posterior joints are synovial joints. The anterior joints is a non-synovial joint.
Yes, sir, true.
Does it have any predilection to non-synovial joints?
No. Actually, predilection is in the form of, there are a lot of theories. Even the formation of syndesmophytes is more common to do with whenever there is a lot of increased mechanical force or heavy work, particularly people who do carry weight and other things. Whenever there is a lot of mechanical force in the non-synovial joints, that is the reason for formation of these syndesmophytes. Maybe that's a separate theory, sir. Maybe can tell you.
Thank you.